It's my pleasure to bring to you another recovery story of a person who has recovered from fibromyalgia. And that person speaking to me today is Sue Ingebretson from the United States. Hello, Sue. How are you doing?
Hi, I'm great. I'm so glad to be here.
Well, I'm very, very excited to speak to you today. I really appreciate you making the time and willing to share your story. Look, in my experience, it turns out that there's really two types of people who recover from fibromyalgia and chronic fatigue syndrome. There's what I would consider the vast majority of people who recover, and they never want to speak another word about it because it has been so traumatic for them whilst they had it, that when they finally get over it, they want to close that chapter in their book. And then there's another group of people who when they recover, their gratitude is such, and what they've learned along the way is such that they feel compelled to share it. Tell me, Sue, what was it like for you to have fibromyalgia? What did it feel like?
Oh, that's a great question, and it's important for me to go back in time and relive that and remember that, because it's so easy to forget, you know, like childbirth amnesia. When you go through something that's very painful, it's the natural human tendency to want to put it behind you and forget. But I think it's important to bring that up because that's exactly what I share, you know, in what I do today. And it was so debilitating and isolating, I would say, you know, besides the pain and frustration and confusion and all those things. And, you know, and of course, it wasn't as mainstream as it is now. And it was, you know, very, very hush-hush. But it was so isolating. When you're in pain, it does not lead you to be in a good place to make decisions, to learn, to cope, to strategize. You know, none of those things come easily in the good times. And when you are so overwhelmed, all of those things are all that much more difficult. So those were awful days. I was just talking to a chronic fatigue friend of mine today saying I wouldn't go back to that for anything. But I would not give up what I learned from it. So I'm still very grateful for it.
Sure. It's funny, you know, like I speak to many people who've recovered from either ME, CFS, or fibromyalgia, and they often say this. Well, virtually all of them have said that they're grateful for the experience or how it changed their lives. And I always feel a bit awkward when I hear it, because I remember what it was like for me when I was sick all those years. And anyone suggesting they'd be grateful for it would have probably had a very strong negative reaction from me, to say the least. But having come out the other end, I fully understand where you're coming from. Tell me, I mean, how did it impact your relationships in your life?
Mine might be different than a lot of other people's, and the reason is I was so stubborn. You know, I'm from the Midwest, I'm Iowan, I'm Norwegian, I am as tenacious as they come, and I was raised to tackle everything head on, but do it for yourself. I was raised to be very self-reliant, and so I did not share what I was going through with most of the people around me. Right. I was afraid, I was scared. I didn't know what I was experiencing, so how could I articulate that? And as a word person, I've been a writer forever, but even me, as a word person, I didn't know how to describe what I was dealing with.
Sure.
So it was something that I couldn't find the words to express, because, of course, half of me thought I was crazy, and the other half was in so much pain I didn't care what the first half thought. And all I had to do is get through each day. You know,
yes.
I was a single mom. I had kids I had to get to school. Literally, there were many days that I crawled for a significant period of time before I could even stand.
Yes.
I would set my alarm earlier and earlier because it took me longer and longer to get going in the morning after a whole night of not sleeping anyway.
Yes. Well, that's right. That's exactly right, isn't it? Tell me, when did you first start getting ill? What were your first symptoms?
I think I did it in segments of time. It really was about 15 years that were pretty awful, and then the last three or four of them were god awful.
Yes.
But I think that, you know, as I later analyzed and put all my symptoms on paper, I'm very much a research person, and as I, you know, put it all out on paper and got a spreadsheet and looked at it all, I could see how these instances of flares followed a specific occurrence, such as a trip, or having, you know, some sort of immunizations, or having a new antibiotic, or getting, you know, some sort of, you know, hormones, or dental work, or extreme chaos at work, or trauma with my children, you know. So I could pattern these big flares later. I couldn't
yes.
at the time. But later I could see how they related to these, you know, big awful instances of what's going on. And the reason I bring that up is that people want to say, you know, is this something that's, you know, you create it because you're under stress? Heck no. You're under stress and your body lives out everything that you're thinking. It's not the other way around. You don't make it happen and so then,
sure.
you know,
sure.
you create it. It's, you know, we all have stress in our lives, but different people take it to different levels. So I had periods of time where 6 months, you know, 7 months, a year, I might be practically incapacitated, and then I'd somehow crawl out of it and then just go, guess I got over that,
mm-hmm.
you know, and then something else would strike. I'd have those symptoms again plus more, you know, and then get okay. And then I'd have those symptoms plus those other symptoms plus, you know.
Yes.
So it would compound and compound.
I think this is sometimes the disturbing thing with the illness, is that the illness progresses, and in my experience, many people actually start with chronic fatigue syndrome and the immune dysfunction, and later on they get fibromyalgia, whereas with some people they start with the fibromyalgia pain and the fatigue is very little, or they get it later, and I have also found that sometimes people are, it depends how they're triggered initially, and that's why I'm curious to see how you were triggered initially. I mean, was there a time you remember where you first got ill, where you first started to have problems at the beginning?
Yes.
What happened at the first time?
I think it was three different events, but they all happened within the same year and a half.
Right.
In my mid-teen years, you know, 14, 15, I had my first dental work, you know, hadn't had up to then, you know, dental work. So I had a whole lot of mercury put in my teeth. I had a, you know, you have natural hormone changes or whatever at the time. I was a horrible eater. I had no idea what I was doing, you know, never had anything healthy in my life. So I think it's a combination of all these things. But the trigger was the dental work. I had not one but three vaccinations for the swine flu that came through Iowa in the 70s in the Midwest. And that very specific vaccination has been linked to several autoimmune conditions.
Mm-hmm.
And so, again, not only one but three. So, I mean, that's a huge attack on the system. And I was in a very tragic school bus accident where we went off a bridge in a school bus.
Mm-hmm.
So this is really common when I talk to clients. There are automobile accidents. There are, you know, so there are different assaults to the body that happen in different ways. There's emotional assault, there's physical assault, there's, you know, external toxin assault, there's nutrition deficits, you know, there all these things combine. But those three main things, I think, at that time created a real neuro response. I had trouble coordinating, I had trouble balancing, and, you know, I mean, this is high school.
Yes.
So,
yes.
You know, and then I got over it and got okay and, you know, moved on. And it wasn't until really my 30s that started to really
come up again.
Compound, yeah.
So when it came up again, did you start by having fatigue or did you start by getting the pain first?
Pain.
And did anything happen? So when this main episode started in your 30s, did anything happen immediately before that? Can you tell me anything about the lead up to that?
It was stress.
Yeah.
So that was a building, you know, that episode was building. Stress,
yeah.
stress, trauma, divorce,
right.
Nasty, you know,
yes.
Major nasty. And in your head, you're going, this is the end of my life, you know.
Sure.
And, yeah, so that kind of, you know, burden you know, yes. what am I going to do with children? How am I going to make a living? You know, all these yes. awful things. So it, that was that portion.
Right.
And then later again, when it happened again, it was a physical accident again.
Right.
Doing something where I, you know, hurt muscles or whatever.
Yes.
But there was also stress involved. And so then that compounded everything again.
Did you find that your pain came on very gradually, or was it like overnight, or how did that come about?
The middle time it was gradually, and I think it's like that boiling the frog thing.
Yes.
You're just so used to it that you just don't recognize it until all of a sudden you're practically incapacitated and can't get out of bed.
Yes, yes.
But it was like little by little by little, the neck hurt, the shoulders hurt, the knees hurt, the hips hurt, you know, and right. then one day you think, oh my gosh, I hurt everywhere. What the heck? You know, I'm 30 yeah. something and I feel like I'm 80. What yeah. the heck?
Yeah. Did you have a lot of other symptoms?
Yeah. Oh, I had gastrointestinal stuff since junior high. Again, right. never putting that together.
Yes.
You know, I just thought that's part of my heritage. I have a very sensitive tummy and, you know,
sure.
food allergies and all that stuff. But I never thought of it as something you could fix or change. I just thought of it is, you know,
sure.
I
sure.
will have this the rest of my life. I never saw it as something that I could actually address or
yes.
approach.
Did you also have, what about sensitivities? Did you have any sensitivities to foods, to light, to sound, to anything like
that? I definitely have food sensitivities. I'm very lucky that I have not had the horrible multi-chemical sensitivities that a lot of people have to sight and sounds. I'm lucky that I did not have the propensity for migraines, although I had, you know, headaches or whatever. I had terrible female problems in those years, so hormones were definitely related.
Right.
And I'm super sensitive to smell,
yes.
where, you know,
yes.
I could get a headache from a car, two cars ahead of me that has yes. their sunroof open and they're smoking.
Yes. Yeah.
Yeah. So I have that. But I know other people who are completely incapacitated by it,
yeah.
so I'm very fortunate I, you know, didn't have
yes.
it that bad.
So that's interesting that you mentioned the smell, and I think this is actually a key symptom, one of the key symptoms. I think that's very insightful in terms of understanding the pathogenesis of the illness. But in terms of other sort of symptoms, did you have experience any mental symptoms as well?
Yeah, and I like that you bring that up because I would never, ever have admitted it.
Yes.
You
sure.
know, we all have our little personality traits, and you could tell me all day long, you're the shortest person I know, and I go, uh-huh, you're Norwegian, you're, you're, you know, incapable of this, you're, you know, you could put me down all day long, but don't tell me I'm not smart.
Yes.
And so for me to be hit there
yes.
was crippling.
Yes.
For me to forget things, because I never forget anything.
Yes.
For me to not be able to put my thoughts in order, that was
yeah.
devastating.
Yes.
And I finally broke that to somebody that I didn't even know that well. I kind of brought something up, and she said, I think you need a little bit of hormone replacement therapy. You know, go get some estrogen. That's going to help that little thing, you know.
Right.
And I thought, sound like it would make it go away, but
yes.
that was my first thought that, huh, maybe it's not just me, and maybe there is something connected. And again, it was a big deal for me to understand that the cognitive, that the digestive, that the coordination, that the pain, that the muscle, that all of that was one big picture. That was
yes.
a big epiphany for me.
Did you now, what about other symptoms, like did you find that you had problems when you stood up, orthostatic intolerance, or did you have any tachycardia or anything along those lines?
I did not have, I had heart palpitations and I still do when I lie on my left side.
Yeah.
But I had horrible costochondritis, although I didn't know the name for it at the time.
Right.
I mean, I had two or three episodes of that were horrific. You know, thought I was having heart attacks, squeezing so bad it just felt like knife tearing, you know, through
right.
my aorta. I mean, that is a horrific pain.
And very scary.
It is. And I was not taken seriously by doctors. I was patronized. My GP was, well, let's try, you know. And I was sent to the specialist, and I was sent to the same specialist three separate times in about a year. he was rude, he was arrogant, and you know, I know that not all doctors are like this, but I was so frustrated at not being heard. Like, why would I want to be there? Why would I want to go? And the very last time I was there, he yelled at me, and he said, "Don't bother me. Come back when you're a male, when you're 100 pounds overweight, and you smoke 3 packs a day."
Because we know what to do with that.
Exactly. Exactly. Other than that, you don't fit my criterion. Yeah. Get out of my office.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. Now, look, it's a bit of a sausage factory, unfortunately, but unfortunately, fibromyalgia syndrome and chronic fatigue syndrome are often in the too-hard basket. And I think it has to do with the way we recover from the illness. And so, look, there's obviously a big frustration, adding insult to injury, being so sick. And for how many years were you sick before you started to make a turnaround?
Really, 15.
15 years. Had you given up at that stage?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. It wasn't a question of, am I going to die from this? The question was when.
Right. Well, so, tell me, what was what was it like when you were at your worst?
At my worst, I felt pointless. Why am I here? I'm an awful mother. I go to work every day because I absolutely have to, but I'm a terrible employee. So what did I have? What, you know, I didn't feel that I was a benefit to anyone, and I didn't. So here's my burden of responsibility. I did not share how bad it was. Again, I was afraid. I was afraid of all sorts of things. You know, losing my job. I was afraid of not being able to support my children. I mean, I had some major fears.
Yes. Yeah.
So I did not share exactly how bad it was, but I couldn't see. I couldn't walk without holding on to things. To me, the end was when I had to buy a cane to walk. I fell all the time. So here I had these horrific symptoms, you know, a horrible pain, I can't, you know, can barely even function. But the most embarrassing to me was falling in public. So, you know, isn't that silly how you can have these awful symptoms, but the ones that make you look embarrassing, you know, are the ones that bother you the most. So dizziness was pretty much the end of my rope. Getting that cane was, to me, the end of my mobility.
Yes, yes. Well, you know, sometimes I say this, only someone with fibromyalgia knows the feeling. Because I think no matter who you explain it to and you try and tell them what it's like, I think people never really quite understand it, what it's really like. Because it's an experience on the inside, isn't it? And especially when we have the cognitive problems and the pain, and no one can really truly appreciate just how bad the pain is. Because pain is not something you can see. You know, if the arm's cut off, you go, whoa, that must be pretty bad. Are you sitting there, you don't look that bad? You're telling me it's bad? Well, you know, I don't know.
Right.
And I think later, that's one of the awful things, you know. And you mentioned also being a parent there. And I have to say that if you see the little kiddie pictures behind me, being a parent myself, it's really one of the toughest things, isn't it? And I wonder about the people listening, how they feel about this as well. Because, you know, We have a responsibility, and I think one of the worst things is not being such a good parent. And I remember at the time, you know, because you find it difficult to cope, because everything is too much, you get over emotional, you know, you're not saying, you're not being, it's, how can you be a good parent when you're that sick? And I think that is one of the most difficult things for people to deal with. How did you reconcile that as you went on? How did you cope with that aspect of it?
We all have different personality types, and I don't know whether it's Scandinavian or Norwegian or Iowan or whatever, but I internalized everything. So you would not have seen me emotional. You would not have seen me angry or, you know, tearful or anything like that. I was just trying to get from this chair to that door,
right,
to my car, to it really
just surviving.
Yeah. That is all I could think about. That really is it. And one thing that I am very adamant about today is that people want to compare. Here, you know, my fibro was worse than yours, mine was better than yours, you know. That does absolutely no one any justice.
Yes.
We all experienced it ourselves to our own level.
Yes.
You know, others say I could not work. Others said whatever. You don't know what you have to do. You don't know what you can do until you have to.
Absolutely.
I had to go to work every day. I would have, you know, not been able to care for my children. I had to go to work every day.
Yeah. No, I totally understand. Tell me, what was the turning point for you? I mean, you know, here you are. You know, you've got an illness. Everyone tells you, we don't really know what it is. We don't know what's going on. You know, people, doctors rolling their eyes at you, telling you to get out of the office. People don't quite believe you. Nothing's really helping. You've given up on recovery.
Mm-hmm.
Well, how on earth do you go from that to where you are now? I mean, what was the turning point?
I had two. So the first one was a stepping stone to the second. The first one was me crying, which you have to know, I don't cry. So
yes.
I was really at my emotional wit's end in a doctor's office talking to a physician's assistant, a very kind person, and I said, I hate this cane. I am so angry. And she said, oh, it's wonderful because pretty soon you'll be disabled enough to need one of those scooter chairs. And then you don't have to worry about parking, or you can get the plaque for your car, and you won't ever have to carry your grandchildren because you'll have them on your lap in this chair. So she was telling me what a positive step that cane was. Now, I understand she was doing her best, and she felt that was affirming. My brain threw the brakes on and said, I don't want that.
No.
That's not what I want. And shortly thereafter, I had another doctor's visit where I was sitting at his mercy. I still had not gotten a diagnosis at this point. And I was sitting in the doctor's office, and he had called, you know, and said that he had the answer for me. And so I had this boatload of symptoms, and I went there, and I thought I was going to get the answer. And he said, you know, I think that you have a cholesterol problem. And I was already taking medications in the double digits. He handed me one more prescription. It was for a statin. And that was my breaking point. Now, I don't
I know, even
in my absolute ignorance, I knew that wasn't the answer.
Right.
And I now, in retrospect, I don't think he thought it was the answer either. He was just grasping. He was just trying to give me something. But that was my first dawning of he doesn't know the answer.
Sure.
My faith had always been in handing my power to other people. I always thought somebody else was going to create this solution for me. That was the first time I saw, you know, like the clouds parted, the sun shone. I'm responsible for my own health. He doesn't have the answer. And if he had it, he'd give it to me. It wasn't like he was hiding it.
Absolutely.
But that was my first dawning of going, he doesn't know. That was so shocking to me.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I know other people are like, duh. But I was sitting there going, he doesn't know. And what I had done was so much research trying to come up with my own diagnosis that when I left the office that day, that's when I got busy creating that spreadsheet. That's when I started tracking, well, what were my symptoms or how did I feel? And it was later that I realized, well, gosh, before that episode, this happened, and then before that episode, this happened, and so I was able to map it out visually for me. It was a 3-page Excel spreadsheet. Maybe it was even Lotus 1-2-3. I don't know. and I took that to yet another doctor, and her response was, no duh. You know, because I said, I think I have fibromyalgia. She said, no duh. Of course you do. And then she turned to a new intern, and she goes, this is not normal. Clients don't come in here with the work done for you. And that was the beginning of my next journey.
Right.
Because from then I felt so empowered for figuring it out myself that I was already on a path of, well, then what else can I do? I already figured out my diagnosis. Now what can I do? What can I do to get better?
It's interesting, Sue, because you're not the first person that I've spoken to who tells me about years of suffering. Years of suffering, and then they get told they have fibromyalgia, and I can think of one lady in particular. She said, they told me it's incurable, there's nothing you can do about it, and she goes, yeah, I'm going to get better. And it's almost a part of the fibro personality. So did they not tell you that you can't get better from fibro? Did your doctor say anything like that? Or did they say you can recover from it?
I never went back.
Oh, I see.
That's not an answer. I'm not telling people to do that.
Yes.
She was very kind.
Yes.
She literally said, no, duh, of course you have fibromyalgia.
Right.
She said, this is a doctor-patient thing where it's 90% you, 10% me.
Right.
You need to tell me what you need or whatever. And okay. I never went back.
Okay. So it was about treating symptoms, but she didn't sort of offer that there was a way to recover per se. Right.
No.
Okay. So what did you do then? How did you get better?
I did what I naturally do. I'm a reader. I'm a researcher. I spent weeks, months, years in every library and every, you know, college library, every, you know, bookstore, read everything I could. And anything that said nutrition helped, I immediately said, nah, that's silly. And, you know,
well, surely you can't be that sick because you've been eating a few hamburgers. I mean, you know, the guy next door has been eating hamburgers. He weighs 130 kilos and he doesn't have fibromyalgia. So, yes, I relate very much to what you're saying. I feel like I'm interviewing myself, actually.
Yeah.
Because that's exactly what happened with me.
I grew up on Kool-Aid and saltine crackers and jam. And so it was a big deal for me to say, you know, what I was going to try. But what I kept finding, and there was no way to deny it, I kept finding a consensus of opinion that looking at the Western medicine side of things, and again, I was taking medications in the double digits. I never found anyone who is using that form of wellness who said they got better. I was reading cases and instances where people healed, and it was the natural holistic route. Now, I still thought they were a bunch of bozos, but I had to check it out for myself as a tenacious researcher.
Sure.
I had to prove it wrong.
That's right. That's right. The skeptic. That's me.
Yes. So I'm so grateful. I make fun of myself all throughout the things that I write. I make fun of myself. And again, I'm so grateful for that personality trait. I am tenacious. I'm stubborn. I'm competitive with me, not with others, but with me.
Yes.
And so I had to try it. And I had to start. I joined a gym, and I had to do it to prove it wouldn't work, because you can't work out when you can't even stand up and you have to use a cane.
Seems
right?
Like a ridiculous thing to say. Yeah.
It was ridiculous, so I had to try it.
Yeah.
And nutrition was my first step, and I did it because that MD had said that the cholesterol thing, so I jumped into a nutrition program to change my cholesterol levels so that I could go back and prove to him that I still had all these symptoms, and I never went back to him either.
Right.
Because when I changed my nutrition, I changed my life.
Okay. So you changed your nutrition. Now, when you're talking about going to exercise, what kind of exercise did you do?
I don't think the order matters, but I'm just to be clear, I started with nutrition first, and I did that for probably 6 months or whatever, and so I started feeling, I had some results that were immediate, but I started feeling better, you know, by about 6 months or so. So then I started doing just a home little piece of crap equipment that I had that I got at Target for $29. I was doing that at home upstairs while I fed my kids their dinner.
Was it like a weights type of thing, or was it like a strength training, or walking, or?
It was like a walking thing, but your feet were sliding on this track. It wasn't a gazelle thing. It was way before that. It was called a fast track.
Okay.
And it was like this scoop thing.
Yes,
and I actually did it so much that I wore out the plastic paddles and I wore out the plastic tracks that it was on.
Awesome.
But I did that for 3 or 4 months and was very competitive to myself about how long I was going to do it and keeping track. And I didn't know that I was building on all these essential tools that I now teach.
Yes.
You know, when you write down your process and you write down your progress, that's where success comes. You need to see your improvement.
Look, this is something I talk about too. It's about building on your successes, because at first, you know, we were so skeptical, nothing works, you've lost hope. And then we can do things and things can get better. But it's important to notice those things, because when you notice how you've actually improved, it gives you, it spurs you on. It gives you confidence.
Yes.
And if you don't notice it, you can think, oh, yeah, you might not even realize how much better you are. So I think it is a very important part of recovery. So you did that sort of exercise. You ate. Did you supplement as well?
No, not at that point.
Okay.
Because I didn't know enough.
And then what happened? Well, 6 months in, 12 months in, your symptoms reduced.
Yeah, and about 12 months in is when I joined a gym.
Right.
And I was still using a cane at that point. I was still dizzy. I had a terrible time with dizziness, even though I was feeling better.
Yes.
And I still had pain. There was no question I still had pain. Yes. And I joined the gym because, to me, that was a real investment. You know, spending money on health, heaven forbid. Mm. You know, that was not, that was a foreign concept to me. To me, it was extravagant.
Yes.
So I joined the gym because it opened up a block from my house. I could walk there.
Yes.
You know, it seemed to me in my face. So, again, I joined it to prove that it wouldn't work. And I walked in there, and I told them all, oh, I have fibromyalgia, and I can't do this, I can't do that. You know, so I went in there like this person saying how this wasn't going to work. And they really didn't want me there because I was probably a big liability, you know, walking time bomb. Even though, again, I was still feeling better. But you were talking earlier about noticing the changes. As I started doing all of these things and working out on the different machines. It was a circuit training. It wasn't curves, but it was similar. It was a circuit training thing. As I was doing this and building relationships, I write about that I was building the core of my body, unbeknownst to me, while I was building relationships and building a better mental perspective of the world.
Sure.
And that joining that gym kick-started my wellness like crazy.
Yes. Can you imagine some people might listen to what you're saying and saying, wow, what are you trying to suggest? It was all in my head? Because, you know, obviously that's what you were faced with. You know, the doctor's looking at you, get out of my office, roll your eyes,
right.
Cholesterol, thinking this was your problems. You know, all these other things. And now you're saying that you start to feel happier. Because a lot of people get accused of it being in the head. They get accused of them being depressed. And I'm not saying they're not depressed. I mean, they may be depressed, but clearly the illness is not depression. So what would you say to those people?
It's a matter of moving forward and trying to focus on what you're doing at the time. Don't look 6 months down the road. Don't look 1 month down the road.
Mm.
Do what you can do that day, but make it a process to where you are affirming yourself with each and every step, because you can't look at the past, you can't look at forward, you can just cope and do what you're doing. But you do have to make it important enough that you do it every day. Are you caring for what you put in your body? Are you caring for what you put on your body? Are you caring for how you think? And of course, getting back to, you know, is it all in your head? Of course not. Mm. And as, you know, there are tons of studies that talk about physical exercise and its effect on your thinking patterns.
Yes.
And, you know, it's the best mood elevator on the planet. It's the best detoxifier on the planet. I am not a fitness person. If anybody saw me, I've never been athletic in my whole life. Nobody would ever say, hey, she's going to be a gym rat.
Mm.
But that feeling of progress, there is nothing better than that feeling of progress. And I got to where I was so focused on meeting my friends there, so there's a huge social aspect to that.
Mm.
I got so focused on that and feeling accountable that I had to be there because I told somebody I'd be there, you know, so there was that accountability factor. There were several months had gone by that I realized I never got my cane out of the trunk of my car.
Yes, that sneaks up on you. Was there a time where you suddenly, where all these symptoms were gone and you said, you know, at what stage do you say, I'm actually recovered?
I don't know how long it was. Probably a year and a half. But definitely within 6 months, I was night and day.
Yes.
But within a year, I was just, you know, feeling great. I still had some residual, you know, issues with the neck and shoulders. But nothing, you know, yes. like it had been in the past. And as it, I went like 2 or 3 years completely symptom free. Right. And so I did walk around saying, cured, done, yes. gone. And then I had an extremely traumatic trip, vacation.
Yes.
That was very traumatic and very stressful, even though it was fun, very stressful. And I came back with the whole shebang, got back onto my fitness regimen, my, you know, eating well. And that's when I realized the third quotient, because I call this the restoration trio. These are not negotiable. You must move every day in some way. So that fitness component is part of it, movement, body movement. You must fuel your body with nutrition, whatever that means to you, you know, holistic, healthy nutrition. And the third component is the stress management or the emotional wellness or, you know, sleep. All those things belong in that that stress management component and what I call emotional wellness. So that was the third piece of the puzzle that I had not respected or didn't know belonged. So those three things are absolutely mandatory. So I am now and have been for 10 years, you know, 95%, sometimes 98% pain-free.
Sure.
But I still have enough symptoms to remind me, oh, by the way, if I don't follow my own advice,
yes,
I'm going to end up, you know, where I was. But the kicker is, if I do something silly or if I trip or, you know, hurt myself or, you know, end up being, you know, in a super stressful environment, my rebound is
yes.
is completely different than it was.
Yes. Okay, so you get like some inklings of symptoms, but in essence, you're living a normal life.
Yeah, so I think of it as like Sabrina. Yeah. Do you remember Bewitched?
I'm
sure I'm older than you are, but Bewitched is like Serena going, hello, I'm your bad side. if you have, you know, an inch of food cake for lunch, you might have some symptoms.
Yes.
So those are, again, yes. I'm grateful. Those are reminders.
Yes.
My body reminds me that I am this big ultimate tuning fork. I am super sensitive.
Yeah.
Sensitive to chemicals. I'm sensitive to emotions. I'm sensitive to everything. And I'm grateful.
Yeah. So the first time you did the recovery, I guess you started with your nutrition and then the exercise. And the whole, I gather, was probably about 2 years till you were fully recovered. When you had that relapse, how long were you until you reached the same stage again? How long did it take you the second time?
Not long. Maybe 3-4 months.
Okay. All right. And then basically...
And right away, you know, I was significantly better within weeks.
Yes.
But I'd say...
Yes. Yes. And see, I think this is the important thing about knowing how we recover and why we recover, because, you know, if you ever have a relapse, you can do it again, can't you? If you know how it worked and why it worked. And, okay. And now you've actually gone on, you actually work now with other people who are unwell, is that right?
Yes. And love every minute of it.
And what do you do? You work as a coach? Is that what you do, or?
Yeah, and I do workshops, I do one-on-one, I do online, you know, activities, and, you know, I'm a writer, speaker.
Yes.
Holistic healthcare practitioner, yeah.
Okay, and you focus on fibromyalgia or a whole range of illnesses?
It's really a whole range, but fibromyalgia, of course, is my own experience. So I have the credibility factor, if you want to call it that, there.
Yes.
And I have people come to me for that. But I end up working with, you know, spouses and friends and, you know, who have a whole range of things. I have a lot of clients that have, you know, any kind of health challenge.
Yes, okay.
In the chronic category.
Right, okay. Well, look, I mean, for anyone who's interested, I'm going to pop a link underneath this interview, and you can find all about out about Sue's website. You have a great blog. I saw you make a recent comment that I had to respond to, and that was very, very pertinent. And funny things that happen around fibromyalgia in the uh-huh. public domain, so I appreciate your voice. And you also have a book called Fibromyalgia. Is that right?
That's right.
Fantastic.
I feel it's very important. It's certainly not something that I ever thought I'd be doing. I was a writer, but I wrote children's works and loved working in the classroom. I was always a volunteer in my children's classroom and my grandchildren's classroom. Never, ever thought I'd be writing a book on health and wellness. But, you know, that's it throws a curve. That's right. Fibromyalgia throws a curve. So here I was writing about it because I had so many people asking, saying, I used to see you walk with a cane and you were 20 pounds heavier and now you're going to the gym. So what the heck happened?
Yeah.
So that's how the book came about. And I feel it's important to know, or at least it was for me, why I got sick. So that's where the fibromyalgia comes in. I've had people say, is that because of why me? No. It's because I needed to know why I was sick so that I could be empowered to put in the how to get better. So you got to know why first before you can approach the how.
Yeah, absolutely. Look, what would be your closing piece of advice to people listening who've lost hope and who've struggled with this for years and feeling the frustrations? What's your biggest or main advice that you'd give people?
I think what I'd say is that there is an inner voice that says what works for them and what doesn't, and I think they need to be respectful that they know more than they think they do. They often have family members. They often have medical practitioners. They have others saying can't, won't, don't, and I think that they need to trust that inner voice that says this is what works for me or this is a potentially, you know, a potential opportunity for me.
Right.
So trusting that there is hope, there is change, there are opportunities, and there are so many different things you can do, but the point is to do something.
Yes.
And respect that inner voice that tells you which direction to go, where to start.
You know, I think that is a very pertinent message, and I thank you for that. I've had people say, you know what, a book can't do anything to help me get better. And I have to say, I agree. At the end of the day, it's action. And unless you actually take steps to change something, nothing will ever happen. Knowledge is only powerful when we use it.
That's right.
Absolutely.
And my book is really what I call a seed planter. It's not a step-by-step guide. You do this, this. It tells my story, and then it gives empowering advice. Advice isn't even the right word. Empowering encouragements on how you might change your thinking to approach this, or this.
Yes.
So what I hear most often is people finish it and say, I feel empowered to make change. Now I'm ready to look at what changes to make.
Absolutely. Well, thank you very much for your taking the time for the interview, Sue. On behalf of everyone listening, I want to thank you for your inspirational message. And, I look forward to keeping an eye on your blog.
Great. And I'm, you know, rebuildingwellness.com is my website, and I'm a total social media geek, so meet me on Twitter. I'm Sue Inge, I-N-G-E.
Yes.
I'm all over Facebook and, you know, happy to connect.
Fantastic. Well, look, I'll pop your details down below the video, and thanks again for the interview.
You betcha. Thank you.
Cheers.